My lecture will be about data science at scale, which I think is something that's very common for people who are doing something that involves large data sets. I will mainly focus on two solutions for it, Dask and Numba. And I will probably won't have enough time for Numba, so I'll just do it a little bit faster. But Dask is very strong, and I really want to get to that one. So the problem is pretty much obvious. You can fit 200 gigabytes between your two fingers, but it's a very problem to fit it into a data frame. Suppose I don't have to introduce pandas here. So there are certain limitations that involve the amount of memory that's available, and it's problematic both in the fact that it has to load into the memory, and second, it's not parallelized by default, so it might take a very long time for anything that is pretty much a little bit more complicated than the usual. So this is me. I'm the data scientist at the cyber intelligence R&D team at Verint, and the lecturer in the course Data Science Bootcamp at NIA. And they say that every presentation is some kind of advertisement. So these are the people from my class. One of them is actually in here. And they are very talented young junior data scientists who are learning currently everything from Python to machine learning algorithms. So if you are hiring, they will finish in about 2 months. It's a great opportunity. You can feel free to contact me. And the main actual reason for this presentation is in Verint, the research team deal with a very large amount of data. We have a solution for homeland security, communication intelligence, cybersecurity. So all of these fields usually require a very large amount of data in the research process. And one option is to have a very strong IT group that will support you and make everything for you. Unfortunately, this option is not available for us. And so we had to find new stuff that will not take a lot of time for us, but will enable us to approach the larger data sets. So this is the reason I'm here. Among other things, I really love Dask. I just ran into it a few months ago while I was struggling to work with PySpark, and it was not an easy experience. And then I ran into Dask, and it really improved both my performance and the time for research was reduced. So thinking about that, I thought about giving this lecture. How many people here do know Dask and use it before? Yeah. How many heard about it? Great. So I'm very happy that people who heard about it but haven't tried it come to this lecture, because I have a very clear goal. My goal is for each one that didn't raise the hand at the start will go back home and, you know, have some kind of a test to see if it is as nice as people say it is. So I will have a short introduction, but mainly I want to focus about, you know, the code. I hope I will have enough time for it. Okay. So the problem about big data is usually not in the collection part, because that problem in a lot of places can be considered as solved, because they have databases, NoSQL databases, with a very good solution. But in the exploration part and in the data munging part, it can be a big problem, and this problem can also affect people who don't have the capacity for IT and to produce all sorts of NoSQL database that might require a lot of time. For instance, if we take a look at the biggest Kaggle competition, then the sizes are pretty much too big to fit into a normal data frame. Just one instance, if you want to work on the Microsoft malware classification, then the actual data is compressed, and when you open it, it's much, much more. So it's literally impossible to work on it straight on. And the usual way to deal with it can be sampling, can be taking all sorts of population one by one, but sometimes these solutions are not good enough. So the available solutions, this is just a small sample of a available solution. I'm sure that you probably use and work with other. Mostly based on a Python interface for a NoSQL database or other databases. And they are a very good solution, but they do require a lot of maintenance and to operate with the sometimes servers. And from my experience, it just took too much time to do data exploration using these products. So dask was developed by Continuum, which is the company that make Anaconda. I'm sure you probably all know that. And they have all sorts of solution, and those two solutions are basically mained and using it for runtime. The object of the compute solutions are to increase the ability of data processing data in terms of size and the time. Okay, so what is dask? Dask is a solution that is based on a graph based for computation, and the basic idea is it takes whatever your functions you are running and parallelize them by making a direct acyclic graph. The solution is maintained currently and very actively maintained by three Continuum members, Matthew Oakland, Jim Christ, and Baker Griffin. This is a very responsive library. They are working very hard on it and giving lectures and promoting it. And why do we actually need parallelism? Well, if you take a normal computing problem, what typically will happen is the computer will process it by just one flow, and then you get a bottleneck to the processor, especially today when we have multiple core computers and other GPUs type of solutions. And the idea is, of course, that once you can parallelize it, the time to process the data will decrease substantially, because you will be able to use all your computing powers. So this is just an instance of some order that is given to an array. The array is divided into 10 the part that contains 10 fields, and each of the chunks is computing sum for itself, and then the sums of sums will go to as a result. Okay, so as I said earlier, dask is I didn't say it earlier actually. Dask is now a part of Anaconda, so you don't have to even pip install it. You just import it Dask, and what it does, it enables you to have this decorator which can announce that this function is a delayed object. And this causes the computation that you make to be delayed and will not actually run. What? To the microphone? Sorry. Okay. So this is a very simple operation. You just take a simple function called increment and add, and you just apply the decorator above it, and this turns into a delayed object. So the main advantage of these objects is that they are not computed in runtime. So if we'll take, for instance, this process, currently the total is not calculated. So it loads everything. It's ready to optimize the result. It's ready to run it, but nothing is actually done right now. So the only thing that is done because of our declaration is it created a direct acyclic graph of the computation that is going to do, which is what we saw earlier. And this, by the way, this is actually available. If you take GraphWiz, this is really cool. And you just visualize, you can have a very complex system and create a graph of it and see how it's supposed to be architectured. And only at the instance that I'm applying the function compute, it's actually producing the work. So you can do multiple things to the, you can apply multiple functions, but nothing will be applied until you will finish it and call a compute. Okay, so I will touch a little bit about another subject. And unite it with Dask. So this is the solution which is a part of Dask. It's called Dask Distributed. And it is aimed to create a schedule for distributed work over network. You can have multiple worker nodes and one scheduler. And in order to run this, solution, all you need to do is just create a new client. It will automatically produce one scheduler client and one worker client, and they will communicate between them. And once you've done this, you can check which are the addresses. So currently, I only have it on a local computer. So the scheduler would be at this port, and the worker nodes will be appearing below. And what is nice, a nice thing that they added, is the ability for you as a user. Just a second. To monitor your jobs. So as soon as I created this client, I am able to access the provided UI interface, which can enable me to work to check the workers, to check their memory. If I have multiple computers, I will see them as different computers, and I can see the task. So after we saw that, I want to use it in order to run in parallel a distributed computing assignment. So what I have in here is just three functions. Each of them have a different sleep time. So you are not able to see it, but it actually is updated. The task will be updated in real time. So once I run it, we will see the task that are running. And we have these two functions with different time for different sleep times. And you can see that it started the first task, the second task. And if you remember, that started with a big green rectangle there. And the second task, and because the first task was still occupied, he started it in this current node. So this is just a small example of how the distributor is assigning the task. And of course, you can have multiple cores. You can do it across different devices. Yes, definitely. You can see which task, and you can actually hover over it and see which one is taking the most time. So I don't have much time, but I just want to touch a little bit about an actual solution that that is using Dask, because a lot of the times when you see a lecture, everything works, and there's no problem, but then you come back home and there are problems. So this is just, I took a normal data exploration from a Kaggle competition, and just transform it to Dask to compare between them. So in here you see the normal reading of the data frames, and in this cell I'm actually producing a new task object. So this is just the vanilla task objects. You can actually control the chunk sizes and everything, but this is as simple as just importing the task data frame as DD and creating a new read CSV assignment. Now, what is interesting about that currently no job has been made. So the only thing that he's done is just created a computational graph that will represent whatever computation he will have to do when he will read the CSV. And once we will ask, we will query something that will require him to do the evaluation, he will do it. So it's completely lazy evaluation, and you can see that when we'll try to do just a simple function. I just took the new Dask data frame, and I just want to have the shape of the data frame. But what I will get an error, because there is no actual data frame currently. And once I will run it, you can see that after running a compute, I can get a normal data frame. So if you can see, I'm comparing the two types in here. One is the data frame before I actually computed it, and the other is just after I run compute. So this is just a normal data frame for every operation that you want to make. But there are a lot of operations you can do without actually computing the data frame and loaded it into the memory. You can do a head query and get the first ones. You cannot actually have the shape of it unless you are querying, because it doesn't know what is the actual shape before computing it. And this is just a small sample of what is done. Is taken out of the string of the timestamp, just the year and the month, and aggregated it to calculate the median, which this is something that I really like, that once you try to run a median, you actually notice that it doesn't have a median by default, and this is because the computation of a parallel median is much more complicated than the mean. So this is one of the instances that there will be a difference between what you will expect from doing normally with the data frame and what you will get out of dask. So again, like done before, nothing will actually happen until I will run the computer function, and then it will complicate it. Then it will calculate it, and once we calculated it, we're able to plot it. So the interaction is sometimes a little bit transparent, because you can not notice whether you are actually accessing the dask or just a normal data frame. But in all terms, it's a very easy and convenient way to parallelize your algorithm. I'm sorry I won't have enough time for Numba, but I will have enough time for questions. Yes.
How do you do dask? Does it hold memory? Where is
it? So after you do dask compute,
if it's like very big, very large data.
That's a great question, actually, because you can see it in the computational graph, in the system that for monitoring it, you can see that it's never actually loading the full data frame, only the chunks of it. Okay, thank you very much.